yet more release, more grace released into our lives. How many know that grace is what we need, you know? Amen. We need more God's ability of working and operating through us than what? In our own limited what? Strength. So, ministering one to another. I know a good way that you can minister to each other. You can pray for each other. Amen. All right. Let me see the hands of those that know that we are to be praying for one another. What are we to be praying about? A lot of things, right? One thing, abound more and more love. All right? Pray that, you know, things be what? Sincere without offense to Jesus God. They live saved lives. Amen. Last time we prayed for the saints, the Lord strengthened them, just like I was ministering Sunday about the three classes of people that we are to be concerned about. Maybe I'll see if y'all can remember the three classes of people that we are to be concerned about would be what?
Backsliders with one.
Okay. The backsliders are to be what? One. Okay. All right. The other group would be who? Okay, believers, right? We've got two categories. We're to pray for believers. We are to be concerned about believers. Okay, seems like to me, people like Sister Denise, it seems like she's making it just fine. But Wayne is making it just fine. You know, I don't see no problem. You look strong. You look strong in the Lord. And I think that many times we just, you know, just like Pastor Hill, you know, I've got very few people seriously pray for me. He said, well, brother, Pastor Hill seems like he can go on his own.
He got Sister
Hill. Sister Hill, she's pretty strong. You don't need no prayer. But you'd be surprised at how many people will never pray for people that they feel like are, you know, maybe been, I start to say, being in the way for a long time. Maybe that's a good way to say it, being in the way. But I think that if we want to enrich our lives, you know, and get more grace going, then we need to begin to implement some of these things that the Bible just repeatedly talks about that we should be doing. You know, last week we went over the scripture in first. You know, these scriptures are very important to pray. Philippians 1, 9, and 10. Everybody said Philippians 1, 9, and 10. Colossians 1, 9, and 10. All right. Then Ephesians 1, what? 16 through 19. Yeah, these are prayers that we can pray. And those are prayers that you can really get some tremendous results. You can pray them individually. And you can pray them for saints. Amen. So, this is the thing that helps to establish you in holiness. See, you have to get the attention away from who? From yourself. And begin to what? Focus on other people. So my endeavor, some of your endeavor might be the same as mine. You know, there are a lot of people, you know, there are people in the church that are not able to be in Bible study. So my goal is to just try to contact a few of them and try to arrange to minister to them the Bible study on phone and then pray with them, all right? How many believe that's a good idea? Amen. If they'll take it, they say, well, I don't want you to minister. I don't thank you. I don't like you. All right, but I know Sister Lenita. You know, she has a really funny schedule. You know, rugged, and she does things that require her to be out a lot. So I called her the other day. I know that she really wanted to be in the Bible study, and I don't know how she worked it and got here tonight. I was just thinking I would have.
I got out first.
You got out there, boy. Oh, praise God. So that would be one call maybe I won't have to make this week. Isn't that good? But go down the line, I guarantee you, it would be 25 or 30 members in this church that would never be able to come to a Bible study for various reasons. Some of them have hindrances, some have conflicts, but that's not a good thing. And I want to capitalize on that because I feel like there is some ministry in that. Because the Bible says that the people that are on the right track, we need to what? Pray for them that they will what? Stay focused, stay on the right track. People are not just going to stay on the right track just automatically. Amen. Today, amen. A thought came to me. He said, a thought came to me, Sister Denise, this evening. I said, man, that spirit said, you ought to just quit.
Oh, wow.
These people don't care nothing about you. They'd be glad if you left. They don't want nobody trying to pray. They don't want nobody interested, you know. Boy, it came on me so strong, I said, I think I will do that. But you'd be surprised of how many people ever say a word to encourage people in leadership. You never say anything. You know, on Sunday, there are certain people I have to lean on. Amen. Because sometimes you just feel like going down to the floor. Amen. And there are about three people that will always come by. Maybe about three or four people, you know, and say, Pastor Hill, amen, that bless me. So you can very easily conclude that nothing you do blesses people. You can very easily conclude that. Amen. So there's a ministry, there's a big ministry that we have within the body of Christ that needs to be released so that we can grow and develop and get established in faith and get established in holiness. Amen. So this is the way you get built up. I mean, you don't get built up just by staying to yourself and keeping, you know, not reaching out, but you go out of your way and try to do something to help saints. I mean, if they seem like they're on the right track and they are encouraged, you know, there are some of you that make it to the Bible study on a consistent basis. And, you know, you make it to prayer, the Friday night prayer. It was just, you know, a small group of people. Amen. But that prayer ministered to me, and if I were at the point of giving in and giving up or getting discouraged, that prayer would have, amen, reversed that decision. Just that prayer. Amen. So I want us, because see, we can't have the church that God really wants us to have when we are not really sowing into each other's lives. Amen. So those prayers, Colossians 1:9-10. Everybody say Colossians 1:9-10. Philippians 1:9-10. Ephesians 1:16-19. And these are scriptures that are showing how we can be filled with the fullness of God. I believe our brother Wayne mentioned Ephesians 3. About being filled with knowing the height and the breadth and the depth and the love of God which passes knowledge, and that causes us to be filled with the fullness of God. See, this is how you get full of the grace of God. This is how we get established in grace. And this is how we build ourselves up on, amen, on our most holy faith as we begin to minister and to share with each other. My goal this week, amen, I know I got to leave town and it makes it sometimes difficult. My goal is this week to call everybody that's not coming on a consistent basis and people that are not able or capable of making it on Wednesday night and to talk with them personally. Talk with them personally about the lesson and prayer. I pray Philippians 1:9-10. I pray Colossians 1:9-10. I pray that the eyes of their understanding might be open. I pray, like Paul said in Colossians 4:12. See, there's a lot of good scriptures, that we could just really be feeding on. And these are scriptures that we can really begin to share as we begin to pray for one another, and it's something that's very, very, very needful. Now, I was talking to Brother, what do you think, George or George or Washington? George.
Yes.
Anybody know it? Say what now?
You're talking about George.
All right. Yeah, he has some very critical needs. Amen. How many knew that? And, nobody knew, okay, but I'm making a point, but there's no way we can really know what people's needs are until we begin to what? Until we begin to connect with them. Right now, believe it or not, this is how you really get established in holiness. This is how you get established in grace. This is how you really get built up, is by abounding more and more in love toward one another and toward what? All men. See, God wants us involved in those that's not saved. Is that right? Those that's not saved. That's God's interest. Those that are backslidden, we'll do what? Deal with them. Amen. It was a brother that was that hadn't been here in 3 months, 2 months. And I just got fed up, you know, hearing his excuses. And the righteous indignation just almost exploded. So I invited him to meet me here at church. And we had a real good session. And a lot of times, things people are dealing with can be easily overcome if somebody would take some time with them and just speak a word in their life. A lot of barriers, a lot of hindrances, a lot of people laying out. Amen. That if we would speak a word, they would what? They would respond. It was a sister here Sunday. I took some time out and just called, and you know, I had much ground to just really kind of talk real firm and strict. But the Lord just said, just pray, just pray, just pray, just pray. I spent all of the time what? Praying. And here's what I do. I have this habit. When I pray, I try to get my message over. I pray the word, and whatever the Holy Ghost needs to say, he'll say it in the prayer. So it's not really me, but it's the Holy Ghost, what, doing the speaking in the prayer. So so I just wanted to encourage you, because this is how we, if all of us work together, really begin to focus on building each other up. And, you know, we got a lot of information that we can what? We can share with members. Amen. So I believe this would be a perfect opportunity for us not only to get to turn the ministry around, but also to build ourselves up, and we can get firmly established in grace. Amen. The Bible says it's a good thing to be what? Established in what? Grace. So we got to share the word of his grace, because that's the thing that builds people up and give them an inheritance among them which are what? Sanctified. So there are three classes of people that God wants us to focus on. It would be the lost, but not only the lost, but he wants us to focus on those that are what? Are not faithful, those that's not consistent, and those that have lost their zeal and their fervor, and that's going in the wrong direction. Prayer will work, a word of encouragement. We want to share some of the topics that we shared in Bible study, some of the material, the Lord's compassion. We have just a lot of material that we can share with people, and they can really be built up, amen, through us. How many think that's a good idea? Three. All right, thank you for those three. Okay, but seriously, we do need to pray, what, one for another. And there's nothing wrong with what? Calling people on the telephone. and what? Pray with them. Amen. Base your prayer on, amen, on the scripture. Okay, now what we can do here, on page 17, seven things, I just want to go over these. Sister Lenita, God bless you. Okay, still call me though.
Okay.
All right. Seven things we see from Philippians 2:19-21. Your primary responsibility as the Lord's ambassador is to promote his interests above your own goals, regardless of your circumstances. That might cause a problem with some people say, well, I don't see why I need to promote God's interests above my goals. Anybody see a conflict there? You know, there's a scripture which says that it says, take no thought for your life, what you should eat, what you should do, or what you should put on. Okay, we have to be able to rightly divide these things, because the Bible does say, set your affection on what? Things above and not things on the earth. So, anybody have a problem with your primary responsibility as the Lord's ambassador is to promote his interest above your own stuff? Anybody having a problem with that?
I don't, but I know some people get confused by that.
Oh.
I think the reason
some people
have that's a good point, brother.
Rod.
I know. Well,
I keep you on the track.
It's all right, yeah.
Yeah, thanks. Is that it seems like it might be, it could seem like it's incongruent, mm-hmm, that you want to put your things, like if a person has a vocation or application, it's like some people may think, well, here it is. I just have to put my goals aside and just do what the Lord said. I don't think that's what it means. I don't see how, why they can't be done simultaneously. Then you can promote the interests of God where you have your own goals too. They don't have to be conflicting. Mm-hmm. As long as your goals, mm-hmm, are in line with the word of God. Mm-hmm. You know, why can't they just go along together? In other words, you don't have to just set aside everything and say, I'm just going to stay in church 24 hours, and I'm just going to do it. That's all. I'm not going to work. I'm not going to do anything else but just stay before the Lord. That's, to me, that's not what this is saying. Mm-hmm. But if a person doesn't understand it, you can have goals and, mm-hmm, objectives and things you want to accomplish, mm-hmm, as long as they're not in conflict with the Word of God. Mm-hmm. And they can go along together.
A good example would be like in the book of Acts. Just for the sake of conversation, say that the professional Christians that was in the book of Acts, the lady that cut the sold purple,
dark,
and several of them had money and land and so forth.
Right.
So you know they were secular in whatever they were doing, mm-hmm, but they took that, yes, and enabled them to take advantage of working for the best. So whatever they were doing in secular life, they just paralleled that and reached over into the ministry side and said, because I'm selling purple, so I'm making it work for the sake of the ministry. Or whatever they've been doing, they used their secular skills to influence what work they did from in the ministry.
I think when the problem comes, mm-hmm, yeah, we're essentially saying the same thing, but mm-hmm, that's a good example. The problem comes when we elevate our goals above God's, you know, purpose and his, and make his become secondary. Mm-hmm. That's where the problem comes. But there is no reason why, mm-hmm, they can't pull together. Mm-hmm.
I remember years ago when I was teaching school, how in the world can you teach school and promote the, you know, the things of God at the same time? Back in those days, you know, I don't know whether, you know, I used to spend periods of time kind of instructing people about you know, values and the things of God. I think every class I ever taught, I taught about the Lord to some extent, some way. I was able to get the message through to every class I remember teaching. And as a result of that, I go back and I meet, you know, go back home or go different places. And I have seen a whole lot of students that were in my classes that are saved today. Some of them are in ministry. And they always go back and say, I remember those sessions that you had with us in the classroom. You know, sometimes it was after class. People came around and wanted to talk about spiritual things. So I think that you can use your whatever vocation, whatever call you have, secular call, I think that you can use that as a platform to really impact people in a whole lot of different ways. Almost every business that you would get in will lend itself to share with people and to influence people and to impact them. I know, like Brother Mariko, he had somebody here the other Sunday that, and Brother Sonny had somebody here, probably somebody that he has connected with in his line of work. All right, so I think that this is something that we can really use to our advantage because, and Sister Shirley, you work at a hospital, right? Anybody there need the Lord, you think?
Some sick people are already saved.
The people that I work with. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Some of you, minister to. So, is there ever an opportunity that you have and ever to say a word for the Lord?
Okay.
Well,
that's where you get most of the credibility. Because you know you have a rapport, right. Therefore credibility can be established. Mm-hmm. That's maybe the easiest way, other than meeting somebody at the service station and saying, hey, what's your name? Come go to church with me. Mm-hmm. Who are you? What kind of church you go to? No.
Well, yeah, building that relationship and getting to know people is always better. Okay, let's move on. Just because we're born again, number two, filled with the Holy Spirit, know the Word, and involved in church does not mean that we are interested in what God is interested in. Anybody go along with that? Just because we're born again, filled with the Holy Spirit, know the Word, and involved in church does not mean that we are interested in what God is interested in. Okay, what do y'all say about that? Okay. Well, many times people feel that when you're born again, you automatically filled with the Holy Spirit and you're in church. You automatically have God's interest at heart. Primary interest. In other words, you're going to be interested in doing the things that God has commanded us to do, like minister to each other or reach out to people that are lost or be concerned about, you know, the different people that God told us to be concerned about. How do you feel about that? You know, sometimes people feel like you automatically are going to be inclined to do that regardless of what the Bible says. The Bible says, set your affection on things above and not on things of the earth. Let this man be in you that was also in what? Christ Jesus. In other words, some things you have to what? Determine that you're going to what? You're going to do. You have to make a decision that you're going to what? Focus your attention on things above. That's what the Bible said. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. That doesn't come automatically because you're saved and born again through the Holy Spirit. You have to make some effort. You have to put forth some effort to what? Seek the things of God what? First. I mean, if you don't do certain things, you're not going to be what? You're not going to be inclined to what? Have God at the forefront of your life.
If you're not, if that would be exactly do anything spiritually, you're not being kind to
right, Sister Denise, you're quiet, sweet boy. I want to hear it again. I know you got something good to share.
I said, first and foremost, if your mind is not renewed by God's word, you will not have any type of desire to do anything spiritual.
Okay, Denise has a good point. She said, if your mind is not being renewed by the word of God, you can slip away from your sincere devotion to God. You can slip away. And that is the problem the Laodicean church, which is the church today, is the last church that we will experience just before the return of Christ. Is that right? And the Bible says that church is going to be the church that will be what? Neither what? Going to be what? Lukewarm. And the scripture mentions also, because iniquity shall abound, the love of many will what? Wax cold. And many authors, many prophets and people that have a good understanding, they feel like the Laodicean church, the church that's neither cold or hot, they're not going to be saved. Because the Lord said, because I'm going to what? Spew you out of my mouth. I would have you what? Hot or cold. So it's bad to be lukewarm, because that's a point, that's a place where God can't really what? Do much at all through you and for you. And that's a point that, you know, that's the place where many times we don't believe it, but lukewarm people, amen, what good are they going to be for the kingdom? It's almost like faith without works is what? Dead. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to call your attention to that. Let's move on. The majority of Christians in the body of Christ will not be interested in what God is interested in. Those interested will always be in the minority. Everybody agree with that? Those interested will always be in the what? Minority. All right. If leaders are interested in what God is interested in, and those following leadership are not, it doesn't have to stop you or slow you up as a leader, even one bit. All right, that's a good point. But it does affect leadership. And sometimes, you know, there are preachers quitting everywhere. There are so many churches just going completely out. And many ministries or ministers are frustrated, they're discouraged. And many of them are because of the conditions that prevail in their local churches. And the spirit of believers today is very difficult to deal with. Okay, the only people who will, now this is number five, the only people who will succeed in their efforts in the kingdom of God are those interested in what God is interested in, those who have laid down personal goals and ambitions and made them subservient to God's will and interest. Amen. The only ones who will succeed in their efforts in the kingdom of God are those interested in what God is interested in, and those who have laid down personal goals and ambitions and made them subservient to God's will and interest. Somebody tell me how that was true in the life of Joseph. How many can run that down in the life of Joseph? You know, Joseph, from the beginning, he had this dream. So he kind of had an outline of what God had for him in the future. But he had to go through a whole lot of what? Bad experiences, right? All right, so he had, did he have to lay down, you know, what Joseph probably wanted? He said, Lord, you showed me these, binding these sheaves in the field and my sheaf, what, rising up above. Joseph probably had that in mind initially, that one day he would reign over all of his what? Brethren and his family. He would be like a king. I imagine he had that in his mind, but when he landed up in Potiphar's house down in Egypt, you know, that's probably was a far cry from what he had what? Envisioned. Or felt like what God had called him to do. Right? And But the scripture says that everything that he put his hands to, God caused him to what? Prosper. Made him a prosperous man, even in Potiphar's house. So in Potiphar's house, was he being involved in his own personal goals and interests and ambitions and things like that? Who was he absolutely being subservient to in Potiphar's house? Right. He put him in charge of everything, but he was what? Subservient to who? To Potiphar. Right? So sometimes, you know, in order to get where God wants you to be, you're going to have to what? Kind of lay your ambition, your goals, and the way you see things and the way you want to have it. You're going to have to what? Kind of lay that aside and let God do it his way. Because many times we don't even understand how God is what? He's preparing us anyway. But whatever he wants us to do, the Bible says God has foreordained, we are created into Christ for good work. His workmanship, thereby created unto Christ for good works. Wherefore, God has foreordained that we should what? Walk in them. The path that God has for us many times is altogether different from the way that we see things. There's no way you can really always understand the path that God has you to travel. Is that a good illustration? Joseph?
Kind of, yes and no.
Okay.
I would say yes, but I'm sitting here thinking that the story of Joseph is one of my favorites of the Old Testament. But this says he laid down personal goals and ambitions.
Mm-hmm.
As many times as I've read that story account, I don't believe it's detailed in there what his personal goals and ambitions were. Yes, the dreams, the sheaves, and all of that. But I'm not sure there was an indication that he laid down his personal goal. He became subservient, true, to his masters. But I'm not sure what his personal goals were from reading that story. Now, I'm not sure that he thought that he was going to be ruling over his brothers. Yes, that dream was there. Maybe I missed something in it. Perhaps I did, but I'm not sure he laid down. But because I'm thinking that because he did become subservient to his master, then God was able to perform in him what God had in mind for him. That he was not only subservient to the master, but he was subservient to God.
When we say subservient, or lay down your goals. In other words, what we mean is probably put what God wants you to do before the things that you really desire or what you feel like, you know, you want to do and all of that. So, but, you know, there's no clear cut. There are many indications that Joseph probably had some. He was a man of had great revelation knowledge.
Yeah.
So I'm pretty sure that he did have a revelation of where God was really taking him. Maybe it wasn't clear, but I do believe that he knew to some extent where God was taking him. But he couldn't dwell on that when God was what? Taking him through all the changes. He had to what? Ignore that and what? Just follow the path that God was what? Leading him. In that respect, I think it could apply. And Moses is very similar. The Bible says that he forsook Egypt because he was in line for the next person on the throne. But he said that he was willing to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. So he kind of made a decision that he would not seek to be the heir of the throne, but he would seek the will of God and let the will of God manifest in his life. So it paid off big time for him. It will always pay off big time. All right, let's do number six. Christians have a responsibility of seeking out and discovering God's interest. God's interest will remain hidden until you seek it out. God's interest will remain hidden until you seek it out. You know, things like we are talking about tonight doesn't register to a lot of believers. Why should we be talking about stuff like this? It doesn't make any sense. Okay, God's interest will remain hidden until you what? Seek it out. Setting your affection is a huge issue. Right? That's what Colossians 3:1 tells us. It says what? Set your affection on what? Things above. And not on things of the earth. It's a decision we must make, and it's a huge issue. You can change your interest by a decision of your will. Okay, any comments on that? Question for thought. How much interest do you...
No, you
didn't do seven. I didn't think y'all would be interested in that. Regardless of the call you have, if the minister and laity seek to find God's interest, there will be a common interest between both, despite their background status and denominational differences. Everybody agree with that? Regardless of the call you have, if the minister and laity seek to find God's interest, there will be a common interest between both. In other words, they will both have a what common bond. All right, now questions for thought. How much interest do you think the average believer has in the things that God is mainly interested in? All right, how much interest do you think the average believer has in the things that God is mainly interested in? And we pointed out the things that God is mainly interested in. All right, Brother Travis, what do you think? The average believer, how much?
About 40%.
All right, about 40% of the average believers, remember what you're saying, has an interest in the things that God has made an interest in. So you said about 40% of the believers in Northside are interested in the things that God is interested in.
Well, I'm glad we figured Northside.
Wait a minute. Don't put us down.
I don't believe it. But in general, I say that because just from what I've seen, with people in general, in and out of here, I'm missing in action a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that the believer, once they're born again, saved, I believe they think that's all they have mm-hmm. to do. But they're done.
Mm-hmm.
And everything else will fall into place.
Mm-hmm.
So they're,
mm-hmm.
once they achieve what they were seeking,
mm-hmm.
But a lot of them, that desire to,
mm-hmm.
you know, to seek more, to know more, to understand God even better, it's just not there because they achieved what they were,
mm-hmm.
What they were looking for.
Okay, I got a good question for you, Brother Travis.
Yeah.
You've been leading prayer how long?
It's been a couple of 3 years.
Okay. Do you believe that? By us having prayer whenever, Monday night, whenever, do you believe that it has anything to do with anything?
Yeah, it has a lot to do with everything. I would take a Monday off every once in a while. I did, you know, if it didn't mean, you know,
okay,
if it wasn't important, you know, to the, it wasn't, the prayer wasn't important, you know, it's all part of being, you know, continuing in, you know, in what we believe in. It's just like getting born again, getting saved, and then never coming back. Because you know, like I said earlier, you seek God, you want to be born again, and a lot of Christians, once they achieve that, then they think that's all they need to do. They don't want to put the work in, or the time in,
right,
or the effort in, you know, to go any higher.
Right.